Hello and welcome to Pendulum Edu, and today we'll be discussing daily current affairs of 16 July 2020. So guys, quickly join this session. We are about to begin, and everyone please follow this daily current affairs. These are very important from exam point of view, as many questions are being asked in government exams like SSC, UPSC, State PCS, Railways, etc. And those who have not subscribed to our channel Pendulum Edu, please subscribe it and also press the bell icon to receive notification. Now let's see what are the news for today. The first news is Ker Puja started in the northern east state of Tripura. So Ker Puja, it is the most unique festival of Tripura and it is celebrated for 2 weeks and it starts at the end of Kharchi Puja. On the occasion of this Ker Puja, the traditional Ker Puja, it is organized in the premises of Ujjayant Palace and it is considered to be the architectural deity of the royal family of Tripura. This Ker, the word Ker Puja is for the Ker who is considered to be the architectural deity of the royal family of Tripura. In the tribal Kokborok language, it is a language of a tribe. So Kokborok language, this Ker literally means designated area. It is believed that this puja protects people from disasters and external attacks. The puja was initiated by the king of the state, and the Adivasis and all the people around the Ker Puja, they burn the fire in their homes and they believe that it will ensure their well-being and exorcise the evil spirit. That is, it will fade away the evil spirit from their lives. Now let's see a question related to the news. Ker Puja is the unique festival of which of the following northeastern states? Tripura, Manipur, Assam and Sikkim. Quickly comment the correct answer. Where is this unique festival celebrated? Ker Puja is celebrated in which northeastern state? Tripura, Manipur, Assam and Sikkim. The correct answer is option A, that is Tripura. Let's move forward. Moving to the next news. Approval of Rs. 107 crores for firefighting facilities in 5 jetties of Haldi Dock complex. So recently our shipping minister Mansukh Mandavia, he's approved Rs. 107 crore for setting up of firefighting facilities in 5 jetties of Haldia Dock complex at Kolkata port. And Kolkata port name has been changed. It has the resolution, or you can say the cabinet has approved the change of name of Kolkata port to a new name. So what is the new name for this Kolkata port? What will be the new name for this Kolkata port? Quickly comment. So it will be renamed as Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Port. Okay. So this Kolkata port, it will be renamed as Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Trust Port. The installation of the state-of-the-art firefighting facilities at Haldia Dock will ensure safe movement of petrochemical products. Right now, the existing facilities in the campus of Haldia Dock complex, these are not in conformity with the guidelines which have been issued by Oil Industry Safety Directorate of the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. Therefore, LPG and other petroleum products, they are not transited from this region, and now there will be a possibility of increasing the handling of LPG and LNG in Haldia Dock premises in the coming time. And as we all know that LPG and LNG, these petroleum products, these are highly volatile and they are also highly inflammable. So they catch fire very quickly. So there is a need for this firefighting facilities in this Haldia Dock complex, and now this will ensure the handling of LPG and LNG in the premises of the dock. The Ministry of Shipping has given priority to the safety and security of handling at all major ports. This will meet global standards of fire safety. So quickly comment, how many major ports are there in India? Quickly comment. Yes, the correct answer will be 13. There are 13 major ports in India. The next news is US government has dropped plans to deport international students taking online classes. Recently, the US government has dropped plans to deport international students which are taking online classes, as recently due to coronavirus pandemic, US government arranged online classes for the next semester, and it also announced that the students who are holding F1 and M1 visa, they are taking these online classes, they'll not be allowed to stay in the US. But then India said that there is a need to rethink about the decision which has been made, because it is important, the student exchange program, the education level exchange between the two countries, it is important for the India-US relation. So now the decision has been taken to drop the plan just a week after announcing the policy. So F1B visas, these are issued to full-time students to study in the United States. So the students which are getting enrolled for full-time courses to study there, then F1 visas are issued for them. And M1 visas, these are issued to students who are engaged in vocational or non-academic studies. So, let's see a question related to the news. Which visa is issued by the US government to students engaged in professional or non-academic studies? M1, S1, L1 and N1. So what will be the correct answer? Which type of visa is issued by US government for professional or non-academic studies? The correct answer will be option A, that is M1. Moving to the next news. United States rejected China's claims on offshore resources of the South China Sea. Recently, US Secretary of State Michael Pompeo said that the Chinese government had no legal basis for unilaterally asserting its authority over the region. So why China is claiming the region? So you can see in the map, this is the location of South China Sea, and this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, these are 9 dash line. This is called 9 dash or 9 dot line. And this line, it is claimed by China that this, the area around this 9 dash line, the area enclosing this 9 dash line, it is a part of China. So this covers main islands of South China Sea. And while according to UN clause, that is UN Convention on Law of the Seas, it says that from the coastline to 200 nautical miles, this is the exclusive economic zone of a country. So this blue dotted line which has been shown, it is the exclusive economic zone of various countries. So this South China Sea is not the region which only belongs to China, but it belongs to other countries which are near around it, which are Taiwan, China, Vietnam, Malaysia, Indonesia, Brunei or Philippines. So these are the countries which are enclosing this South China Sea. And in the South China Sea, first of all, this South China Sea, it is located in Western Pacific Ocean in the Southeast Asia. And there are many islands in this South China Sea. These are Paracels Island, Spratly Islands, and this Scarborough Shoal Island, Fiery Cross Reef. Some of these are, this South China Sea consists of these type of islands. And the yellow dotted islands which have been marked, this Paracels, Scarborough Shoal and Spratly Island, these are the islands for which are still disputed. No country has the full claim on these islands. And the reason why China is claiming South China Sea, there are two basic reasons. First is economic reason. So economic reason is that resources are there. So any country which will have the full access to the South China Sea, then they can get resources of, there are oil fields also, oil wells also are there. So various type of resources will be available for that country. So economically it is important, and secondly, this is also strategically important because it is the major area which is surrounded by many nations, and any country which is having the rights over this area, it can also control other countries or nearby these regions. So this is also strategically important region. Therefore, that is why China is claiming this region. And also China keep claiming many other regions. Recently you can see Galwan Valley of India, it was claimed by China. This is the aggressive policy of China through which it does such things. Galwan Valley was claimed, and Sakteng Wildlife Sanctuary that lies in Bhutan. So this was also claimed by China. There was an island which Japan is having right over that island, which is the Senkaku Island, was also claimed by China. So China's aggressive policy is such that the regions which are इकोनॉमिकली स्ट्रैटेजिकली विच आर इम्पॉर्टेंट दीज आर बींग क्लेम बाय चाइना. सो दिस वॉज ऑल साउथ चाइना सी डिस्प्यूट. सो वेन एवर इफ अ क्वेश्चन इज बींग आस्क फ्रॉम साउथ चाइना सी, आई होप यू विल बी एबल टू सॉल्व दैट क्वेश्चन, वेदर इट इज रिलेटेड टू रिटन आंसर और इट इज रिलेटेड टू द ऑब्जेक्टिव क्वेश्चन. नाउ लेट्स सी द क्वेश्चन रिलेटेड टू द न्यूज. विच ऑफ दीज कंट्रीज आर सिचुएटेड ऑन द कोस्ट ऑफ साउथ चाइना सी? इंडोनेशिया, मलेशिया एंड फिलीपींस. सो यू हैव टू सिलेक्ट द करेक्ट आंसर यूजिंग द कोड्स गिवन बिलो. 1 and 2 only, 2 and 3 only, 1 and 3 only, 1, 2 and 3. So quickly comment the correct answer. Such type of questions are asked in state PCS examination. Which of these countries are situated on the coast of South China Sea? So you can understand that why it is important to study maps, because such type of questions are being asked. And if you are not aware of the location of the things, that where a particular place is located, then you will not be able to answer such questions. So the correct answer for this is option D, that is 1, 2 and 3. All these countries, these are situated on the coast of South China Sea. Now let's move to the next news. On July 13, the 206th birth anniversary of a Nepali Adikavi, Bhanubhakta Acharya was celebrated. He was a very famous Nepali poet, translator and writer. And he was the first writer who translated the great epic Ramayana from Sanskrit to Nepali. So therefore, he is very famous. And he was born on 13 July 1814 in Nepal. So he's the personality in news. So the question can be asked that this Bhanubhakta Acharya, he is the writer from which country? Such type of question can be asked. So he belongs to Nepal. Now let's see a question related to the news. Which of the following statements is true? So from art and culture section, these such type of questions, or you can say from personality news, a question can be framed like this. On July 13, 206th birth anniversary of Nepali Adi Kavi Bhanubhakta Acharya was celebrated in Sikkim. Second, he was the first writer who translated the great epic Ramayana from Sanskrit to Nepali. So which of the statements is true? One only, two only, both one and two, and none of the above. Quickly comment the correct answer. What will be the correct answer for this? The correct answer is option C, that is both 1 and 2. That is both statements are true about Nepali Adikavi Bhanubhakta Acharya. Now let's see the next news. July 15 is celebrated every year as World Youth Skills Day. And the aim of this day is to raise awareness among youth about the development of technical, vocational, education, training and other skills which are relevant to both local and global economies. The theme of this year is Skills for a Resilient Youth. And in November 2014, United Nations General Assembly declared 15 July to be celebrated as World Youth Skills Day. Recently, Prime Minister Narendra Modi addressed a digital conference on the occasion of World Youth Skills Day. And this conclave, this digital conference, it was organized by the Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. And this year it also marks the 5th anniversary of the launch of Skill India Mission. So what is this Skill India Mission? So first we'll discuss about Skill India Mission. So this is a mission of Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. And this Skill India Mission, it was launched in 2015 and it is a umbrella scheme. So an umbrella scheme means that it is a mission which covers many schemes under it. So under the Skill India Mission, there are many schemes which aim to increase or impart the skills among the youth. So the aim of this scheme, this mission, you can say Skill India Mission, it aims to provide training, you can say market relevant training. Market relevant skills training to more than 40 crore youths. By which year? By 2022. So this is the aim of the government, that is under Skill India Mission, market relevant skills training should be imparted to more than 40 crore youths by 2022. So this is the aim under Skill India Mission. And also we know that there is a gap right now. There is a gap between what the market relevant skills are required and what the currently the youth have. So to bridge that gap, this Skill India Mission plays a major role. And now 5 years have been completed for this mission. Now the question for you guys, on which day is World Youth Skills Day celebrated every year? 15th July, 20 August, 16 September and 10th October. Quickly comment the correct answer. When is this World Youth Skills Day celebrated every year? The correct answer will be option A, that is 15 July. On 20th August, World Mosquito Day is celebrated. The aim of this day is to create awareness regarding the mosquito-borne diseases like dengue. And 16 September, World Ozone Day is celebrated. The day is celebrated to create awareness regarding the importance of ozone. As we all know that ozone is getting depleted, and depletion of ozone layer can lead to skin cancer and climate change like issues. And 10th October, World Mental Health Day is celebrated to create awareness that many people in India or across the world, I would say specifically it is World Mental Health Day. So across the world, many people are facing depression, anxiety, such type of issues. So this stress need to be managed, and people need to be create awareness. The stereotypes which are related to mental diseases, that should be removed. So this is the main aim of that World Mental Health Day. Now let's move to the next news. An act was introduced in the US to ban Chinese authorities enforcing repressive laws against Hong Kong. So recently, US President Donald Trump, he signed a bill to ban Chinese authorities which are enforcing repressive laws against Hong Kong. The law provides a powerful tool for the US administration to hold individuals and institutions responsible for ending Hong Kong independence. Recently, China enacted a law, which is security law, to end Hong Kong's special status. This status, it was given to Hong Kong under the 1984 agreement between China and Britain, and now this special status has been ended. And in 1997, this Hong Kong was, which is the former British colony, it was brought back to Chinese rule with legislation protecting the freedom of speech, assembly and press until 2047. So under the agreement, the Hong Kong was given to China to protect its freedom of speech, assembly and press until 2047, and now the Chinese have passed a new security law which has ended Hong Kong's special status. So let's see a question related to the news. Hong Kong was the colony of which country? Spain, UK, Denmark and France. Quickly comment the correct answer. Hong Kong was the special colony of which country? Spain, UK, Denmark and France. The correct answer is option B, that is UK. Moving to the next news, commander level talks between the Indian and Chinese armies begin at Chusul in eastern Ladakh. So as we all know that there was a dispute going on between Indian armies and Chinese army near the Galwan Valley, and after that the talks takes place between the National Security Advisor Ajit Doval and Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi on 5th July. After that, the two sides decided to end this violence, and they said that there is a need to better the relations between the two countries, and for that there is need to maintain peace at the borders. So therefore, after that, this the second level talk, that is commander level talks, they have started between Indian and Chinese armies at Chusul in eastern Ladakh. This dialogue, it mainly focuses on the second phase of the retreat of two armies from disputed sites of line of actual control. What is this Chusul place? This is a village which is located in Darbuk Tehsil in Ladakh, and people of this village, these are mostly illiterate and these depend on goat and yak farming. The place is famous as Indian army here fought during the Indochina war on 18 November 1962. So this place is important from that point of view. Now let's see a question related to the news. Where is the Chusul village recently in the news located? Kerala, Himachal Pradesh, Ladakh and Bihar. Quickly comment the correct answer. Where is this Chusul village located? The correct answer is option C, that is Ladakh. Moving to the next news. IFSC banking unit will be set up by HSBC in Gujarat, Gift City. So recently HSBC, which is Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation Limited, which is the world's largest financial services organization, it has received approval to set up a IFSC banking unit at Gift City, Gandhinagar. Presently in the country for more than 160 years. So this HSBC Limited is present in India for more than 160 years, and this development is a major milestone in India for HSBC. And till now, 13 banks, they have set up their IFSC banking units in the GIFT IFSC. The cumulative turnover in the banking vertical has exceeded US$28 billion, and GIFT IFSC has contributed nearly 11% to India's total financial service exports. So this is a good initiative. Now let's see a question related to the news. Which of the following statements is not true? Read the question carefully. It is written that which statement is not true. You have to tell that. So IFSC banking unit will be set up by HSBC at GIFT City, Gandhinagar. Second statement is HSBC is the world's largest financial services organization. So one only, two only, both one and two, and none of the above. So which statement is not true, which is incorrect? You have to tell that. The correct answer is option D, that is none of the above, that is both statements are true. Moving to the next news, Madhya Pradesh is ahead in all states implementing the PM Swanidhi scheme. So PM Swanidhi scheme, which was started by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So this scheme, which is a central government scheme, it aims to help the street vendors, and its full form is Prime Minister Street Vendor Atmanirbhar Nidhi Yojana. And in this, more than 15,500 persons in Madhya Pradesh, they have been provided loans under this scheme. So therefore, Madhya Pradesh is ahead in implementation of this PM Swanidhi scheme. And the objective of this scheme is to help revival of the business of these street vendors, which have been closed due to COVID-19, by providing them special micro loan facilities. And under this scheme, rupees 10,000 loan can be availed by a street vendor. And if he repays the loan, within one year, then he'll get a 7% interest subsidy. Okay. And along with this, if he makes a timely repayment of the loan, then he can avail, for the next time, he can avail the loan of rupees 20,000 and then rupees 30,000. Then it will go on like this, if he makes the timely repayment of the loan. And the duration of this scheme is till March 2022. So this is important, that this scheme, it will remain in force till March 2022. 22, the street vendors can avail the loan facility under this scheme till March 2022. Now let's see the question related to the news. What is the time limit for PM Swanidhi scheme? Quickly comment the correct answer. March 2022, March 2023, March 2024 and March 2025. Guys, keep commenting the correct answer. Keep following Daily Current Affairs. And you can also download from the description link the monthly current affairs PDF for the month of June, which is available in Hindi as well in English. And those who are preparing for banking exams, banking monthly current affairs are also there. So you can also download that. The correct answer for this is option A, that is March 2022. Moving to the next news, Chief Minister of Arunachal Pradesh released a book called, which is titled Tangmas. So this book, which has been released recently, the full title of that book is Tangmas, an ethno-linguistic study of the critically endangered group of Arunachal Pradesh. Tangam is the language which is spoken by a little known community within the large Adi tribe of Arunachal Pradesh. So it is the responsibility of the government to protect the culture and language of the tribals, or you can say minorities, which are present. And since this language is very rarely spoken, so it becomes very important. It is one of the critically endangered language. So automatically it becomes very important to be conserved, because it is now only spoken by 253 people in Kuging village. So we can understand how important this is to conserve such type of languages, which are spoken very rarely, to keep the diversity alive in India. According to UNESCO's World Atlas of Endangered Speech 2009, Tangam, an oral language, belongs to the Tani group. So according to the UNESCO's one speech of 2009, Tangam is considered to be an oral language which is belongs to a Tani group, and it is marked as a critically endangered language. More than 26 languages of Arunachal Pradesh, they have been identified as endangered language in this report. So it is important to conserve all those languages and identifying those languages which are critically endangered so that these can be preserved for further research or further keeping alive the diversity of India. Now let's see a question related to the news. Tangam is the language spoken in which state? Arunachal Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. Quickly comment the correct answer. Tangam is the language spoken in which state? The correct answer will be option A, that is Arunachal Pradesh. Moving to the next news. Under Operation Muskaan, 312 children were rescued in one day in Krishna and West Godavari districts of Andhra Pradesh. So recently, Andhra Pradesh Director General of Police or DGP, Dr. Gautam Sawang, he has started the week-long Operation Muskaan at the police headquarters. And what is the purpose of this Operation Muskaan? First, to detect the missing children which are brought from other states to the Andhra Pradesh and preventing child labor and bonded child labor. Children engaged at domestic help, these are also need to be saved under this Operation Muskaan. So it was a week-long operation and under this 312 children were rescued in one day. 125 children including 24 girls belonging to various places were rescued from Krishna district. In West Godavari, 130 children were rescued and all except one were reunited with their parents after proper counseling. And what is this Operation Muskaan? This is one of the major initiative of flagship scheme of Ministry of Home Affairs to rescue and rehabilitate missing children. So you can relate from Operation Muskaan, the word Muskaan, you can relate it to smile, and the smile of a child, it is very cute. As you all know, we all want that smile should remain on the face of children. So from there, the name has been chosen Operation Muskaan, and it aims to rescue and rehabilitate missing children. So if you will relate any operation or government scheme with some mnemonics, then you will be able to remember it for a long time. Now let's see a question related to the news. What is the purpose of Operation Muskaan? Detection of missing children, preventing child labor and bonded labor, to save children engaged as domestic help, and all of the above. So what will be the correct answer for this? What is the purpose of this Operation Muskaan? The correct answer will be option D, that is all of the above. Moving forward, the next news is Union Human Resource Development Minister, that is HRD Minister, issued guidelines which is named Pragyata on Digital Education. So recently, Pragyata, which are guidelines on digital education, these have been released by Human Resource Development Minister, and this aim to assist school heads, teachers, parents and students in e-learning. The instructions, they provide a detailed action plan to advance online education with better quality, because we all know that due to COVID-19, schools have been closed and more than 240 million children which are enrolled in schools, they are affected. And since the students and teachers, they are not accommodated to this digital education, digital platform, so these guidelines have been issued so that there can be an ease for the teachers, parents and also students. In addition, they'll also check the number of online sessions in a day and its duration for students from first grade to 12th standard. So in this, basically for the pre-nursery to first class, you can say before first class, so you can say, so the session will be for 30 minutes only in a day. And for 1st to 8th class, the session will be of 1.5 hour per day. The classes will be there only for 1.5 hour per day. And from 9th to 12th classes, it will not exceed more than 3 hours. So these guidelines have been given in this Pragyata on Digital Education. And in these guidelines, 8 steps of online digital education are described. That is, first of all, planning is required, then review, then arrangement, and then guidance to the students. Then discussion with the students, then assigning them the task, then tracking that what are they doing, the tracking of the syllabus being covered, the tracking of the performance of the students, and then appreciation at every level, that is appreciation for schools, appreciation to teachers, appreciations to the parents, appreciation for the students as well. The guidelines for physical health and mental health emphasize that children do not suffer from excessive stress due to prolonged use of digital equipment. So because as we all know that we are not accommodated to this digital equipments, and prolonged sitting of or prolonged classes of these through this digital platform, then it can cause excessive stress in the children, or they can get negatively affected. They can have some sitting defects, eye problems or other physical problems. So as to avoid all those things, these classes duration have been reduced for per day. From pre-nursery to first class, it has been made for 30 minutes. First to eighth, it has been made for 1.5 hours. And from 9 to 12th, it has been made for 3 hours. So this decision was taken keeping in mind the health, mental health and physical health of teachers as well as students. Moving to the question part, what is not true in relation to the famous word Pragyata? These are guidelines issued on digital platform. These have been issued by the Ministry of Home Affairs. These instructions provide a detailed action plan to advance online education with better quality, or these guidelines provide 8 steps for online digital education. So which statement is not correct? You have to tell that. The correct answer is option B, that is, these have been issued by the Ministry of Home Affairs, because these have been issued by the Ministry of HRD, that is Ministry of Human Resource and Development. Now let's see the next news. A low-cost, eco-friendly and long-term supercapacitor electrode, which has been constructed from industrial waste cotton, has been made by the scientists from the International Advanced Research Center for Powder Metallurgy and New Material, that is ARCI. The supercapacitor which has been developed, it can be used as energy harvester storage device. And this is the first time an environmentally friendly, cost-effective, scalable and alternative aqueous electrolyte has been discovered through any natural seawater. The supercapacitor, it can be used in place of existing aqueous-based electrolyte. So, as you can see that there are batteries. If we charge the inverter, or if we store any, this is a solar power plant. This is a solar panel. And it is receiving this solar energy from the sun, and from this solar panel the energy will be stored in a chemical battery. And this supercapacitor, it can replace this aqueous based electrolyte which is filled in this storage device, and it can act as an energy harvester storage device. It can be used instead of that storage device. This study provides a solution for the manufacture of supercapacitors from abundant materials such as waste cotton and seawater. So this supercapacitor has been made using the industrial waste cotton and seawater only. So this is a classic example of creative science for theory of long-term green processes and also the wealth creation from waste. So the concept of waste to wealth, or you can say waste to energy. So this is the classic example for that. That is waste to wealth. The wealth, this can, from the waste, that is industrial waste, cotton and seawater, this supercapacitor has been developed, which can be used as energy harvester storage device, so that the principle for waste to wealth or waste to energy has been proven by this creative science. The International Advanced Research Center for Powder Metallurgy and New Materials, that is ARCI, it is an autonomous organization of the Department of Science and Technology. So quickly comment where the headquarters of this institute located. Quickly comment where are the headquarters of ARCI located. So its headquarters are located in Hyderabad. And it has two more locations where this work is conducted for this ARCI. That is, the operations are also conducted at Chennai and Gurgaon, but the main campus is at Hyderabad. So its headquarters, main headquarters are located in Hyderabad. So the questions have been asked that where this a particular institute or organization headquarters are located. So since this ARCI has been in news before also, so you should know that where are its headquarters located. So it is main campus, it's there in Hyderabad. What is supercapacitor? It is a new generation energy storage device. It is more stable and it will feature ultra fast charging as compared to conventional capacitors. It is also important in the direction of extensive research due to the similar benefits of lithium-ion battery. So as it can act as energy harvester storage device, so it can also give the similar benefits of that of a lithium-ion battery. So you can see over here that this ARCI that is built by the supercapacitor built by ARCI, it can act as a storage device for storing the solar energy in the form of electrical, which can be further used at electrical energy. Now let's see a question related to the news. Which of the following statements is true? Recently, long-term capacitor electrode have been manufactured from industrial waste cotton. Second, it can be used as energy harvester storage device. So which statements are true? One only, two only, both one and two, and none of the above. So what will be the correct answer for this? Quickly comment. The correct answer will be option C, that is both 1 and 2. So friends, here we have covered the daily current affairs and related questions of 16 July 2020. I hope you like this session. Please like it, share it as much as you can. And if you have any doubt, you can mention that in comment box. And keep following daily current affairs. We'll meet you again. Thank you so much.